गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन. सो टुडे माई सेल्फ डॉक्टर निधि अग्रवाल, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर इन पैथोलॉजी डिपार्टमेंट, आई एम गोइंग टू टेक 3 क्लासेस ऑफ हिमोलिटिक एनीमिया. सो वी विल डिस्कस टुडे थैलेसीमिया. सो इन ब्रॉड टर्म्स द हिमोलिटिक एनीमिया वी कैन डिवाइड इट इनटू 2 टाइप्स. फर्स्ट इज एक्स्ट्रावेस्कुलर हिमोलिसिस and the second one is intravascular hemolysis. So what is extravascular is when the hemolysis or the breakdown of RBCs, it occurs outside the blood vessels, that means in the bone marrow or in the spleen, so it is hemolytic anemia. But when the hemolysis occurs inside the blood vessels, then it is intravascular hemolysis. So today we will deal with thalassemia. Thalassemia is very important to know about the thalassemia, because first it is very important for your exam, as well as this is important to understand as it is the commonest form of hemoglobinopathy. And about 250 million people, that is 4.5% of world population, carry thalassemia gene. So we will first see the structure of hemoglobin. So what is hemoglobin molecule? Hemoglobin is made up of heme and globin, and it accounts for approximately 90% of dry weight of mature RBC. That means a mature RBC contain 90% hemoglobin. It consists of 4 heme groups, each surrounded by a globin chain forming a tetrahedral structure. This you can see in this diagram. Here these black molecules, these are heme molecules. Okay, so 4 heme molecules, and these are surrounded by 4 chains, 2 alpha chain and 2 beta chain, that is in case of adult hemoglobin. And this heme molecule, it is made up of iron in the form of ferrous. Okay, so iron and protoporphyrin. Now each heme consists of porphyrin, to which an atom ferrous ion is attached. Production of globin chain is regulated by alpha and beta genes. Okay, so mind it, and you have to concentrate on this, that the production of globin chain is regulated by 2 types of genes: alpha genes, beta genes. Alpha genes, they produce alpha chains, and beta genes produce non-alpha chains. So what are alpha genes? Alpha genes produce alpha chains. What are alpha chains? Alpha chain and zeta chain. Zeta chain is also a type of alpha chain. And the beta genes produce non-alpha chains. What are non-alpha chains? Epsilon, gamma, beta and delta. So during embryonic life, alpha gene produces zeta chain only with a little alpha chain, and beta gene produces epsilon chain with little gamma chain. Okay, in the embryonic life. Now the third trimester onwards, alpha gene produces alpha chain and beta gene produces gamma chain with a little beta and delta chains. 30th week postnatal, beta gene produces beta chains predominantly. So this is very important to understand, because here you can see in the embryonal period, what is the globin chain here? It may be Gover 1 type, Gover 2 type and Portland. It depends on the type of chains formed, that is zeta 2, epsilon 2 in the embryonic life, it is known as Gover 1, alpha 2, epsilon 2 is Gover 2, alpha 2, gamma 2 is Portland hemoglobin. Now the fetal globin chains, fetal globin chains, that is particularly in the third trimester, now switch over to alpha 2, gamma 2, alpha 2, gamma 2. And it is known as hemoglobin F, that is 80% of hemoglobin. Now alpha 2, beta 2, HbA, that is 20%. Alpha 2, delta 2, that is HbA 2, 0.5%. So in the fetal life, there is 3 types of hemoglobin. Now the adult globin chains after 30th week, alpha 2, beta 2, that is HbA, predominant hemoglobin is HbA, that is 96%. Alpha 2, delta 2 is HbA 2, that is less than 3.5%. And alpha 2, gamma 2 is HbF, that is less than 2%. So this whole story is all about the type of globin chains produced during different phases of our life. Now we will go directly to the thalassemia. Now what is thalassemia? So thalassemia is a heterogeneous group of disorders with a genetically determined reduction in the rate of synthesis of one or more globin chain of hemoglobin. Okay, either alpha, beta, gamma and delta. So there is reduction in the synthesis. So this is quantitative defect. Okay, we classify according to the chain whose synthesis is reduced or absent. The thalassemia are designated as alpha thalassemia, beta thalassemia, gamma thalassemia, beta delta thalassemia, epsilon gamma delta and beta thalassemia. Now the important one is alpha thalassemia. So normally there are 4 globin genes. Okay, so we have 2 alpha globin chains but 4 alpha globin genes. So alpha thalassemia syndromes are classified by the number of genes deleted. Okay, so alpha thalassemia, here what is alpha thalassemia? When there will be reduction of number of alpha chains. So this is due to reduction in the number of genes. So first is the silent carrier. Silent carrier, when there will be deletion of one alpha gene out of 4 alpha gene. Now alpha thalassemia trait is when there is deletion of 2 genes, okay, out of 4 genes. So it is alpha alpha minus minus or alpha minus alpha minus. 2 genes are responsible for formation of one chain. So this is one chain and this is another chain. Now HbH disease results from deletion of 3 genes and hydrops fetalis is deletion of all 4 genes. So what happened in HbH? Here 3 alpha genes are deleted. So the alpha gamma chains are in excess in infancy when there will be decrease in the alpha chain. So in the infancy, what is the predominant type of chain other than alpha is the gamma chain. So when there will be decrease in the alpha chains, there will be increase in the gamma 4 chains. So there will be gamma 4 chains only. And this is known as HB BART in cases of infancy. But in older children, when there will be formation of beta chains instead of gamma chains, then there will be excess of beta chains. Okay, so then there will be formation of beta 4 instead of gamma 4. Now this is known as HbH disease. And the other one is hydrops fetalis. Here there is deletion of all 4 genes. Okay, so what is hydrops fetalis actually? It is a deletion of all 4 alpha genes and here there is their intrauterine death of baby, and if it born then dies within first 2 hours. There will be moderate to massive hepatomegaly in cases of hydrops fetalis due to extramedullary erythropoiesis. Now when there will be HB bars, so these HB bars have gamma 4 chain. So these gamma 4 chains have high affinity for oxygen. So if there will be high affinity for oxygen, then there will not be any dissociation of oxygen from hemoglobin. So then there will be tissue hypoxia and it causes fetal death. also you can get a short note on Hydroxyphytalis. Now coming to the beta thalassemia, which is the most important thalassemia syndrome. So a belt running from the Northwest Africa, Pakistan, India, Southeast Asia, here the thalassemia cases are more, and it is also prevalent in Greece, Cyprus, Sardinia, Italy and Thailand also. Now beta thalassemia, what is the genetic behind beta thalassemia? So you have to remember point mutations. So beta globin gene, okay, like alpha globin gene, there are beta globin genes also. So the beta globin gene is located on chromosome 11q. More than 200 mutations producing beta thalassemia are described, and most of which are point mutations. So you have to remember point mutations. Now what is the inheritance? The inheritance is autosomal recessive. What is autosomal recessive here? So the disease exists both in homozygous and heterozygous state. Homozygous state, when there will be beta thalassemia major. Homozygous state is in beta thalassemia major, and the heterozygous state will be seen in beta thalassemia minor. We will look further. Now, what is beta thalassemia major? It is also known as Cooley's anemia. What is the age of presentation of beta thalassemia major? As you all know, HbF, that is alpha 2 gamma 2, is the major hemoglobin in fetal life and at birth. So after birth, hemoglobin F is reduced or replaced by HbA, that is alpha 2 beta 2. So the previously it is alpha 2 gamma 2, now they're replaced by alpha 2 beta 2. And HbF level falls to 25% at first month, 5% by 6 months. Thus, beta thalassemia, a disease of beta chain, manifests in second half of first year of life. Okay. You can understand this because beta thalassemia means there is reduction of beta chain or there is complete absence of beta chain. So when there will be beta chain reduction, okay? So beta chain reduction, it affects alpha 2 beta 2, not alpha 2 gamma 2. Mind it? So alpha 2 beta 2 will be decreased. So alpha 2 beta 2 is adult hemoglobin. And adult hemoglobin, when there will be adult hemoglobin is there? The adult hemoglobin is there after 6 months. So the disease manifests in after 6 months of life, that is second half of first year of life, not in the previous 6 months. Now it is of two types, beta 0 and beta plus. What is beta 0 here? Beta 0 is a homozygous state. Okay, beta 0 means there will not be any beta chain, that is characterized by complete absence of beta chain synthesis. And what is beta plus? Beta plus means there is incomplete suppression. That means there are some beta chains formed. So depending on this, we will divide it into homozygous form and heterozygous form. Now what is the pathophysiology here? There is reduced or absent production of beta chains. So when there will be reduced or absent production of beta chain, it will result in net decrease in hemoglobin production. If there will be decrease in beta chain, it will ultimately affect the hemoglobin production. So there is decrease in the hemoglobin production and imbalance in the globin chain production. What is imbalance? If there will not be any beta chain, then there will be compensatory increase in other chains. Okay? So what is net decrease in hemoglobin production? It leads to reduced mean corpuscular hemoglobin and mean corpuscular volume. So there is decrease in the MCH and MCV, and the other thing, it will lead to excess of red cell membrane compared to its volume. Volume is mainly because of hemoglobin content. If hemoglobin content is decreased, then the volume is decreased, and if volume is decreased, then the relatively red cell membrane is in excess. Okay? So So this will lead to extra membrane formation, and this extra membrane accumulates in the center of the cell, giving a central dot. Okay, this is known as target cell. So target cell we can see in thalassemia, in the peripheral blood smear. Now, what is the imbalance of globin chain synthesis? Imbalance of globin chain synthesis leads to deficiency of beta chain, leads to accumulation of alpha chains. When there will be decreased beta, there will be accumulation of alpha. Okay, and gamma and delta chains compensate to absorb these alpha chains. Okay, and gamma has higher affinity for alpha chains. So jitna bhi गामा है वो सारा अल्फा से कंबाइन हो जाएगा क्योंकि बीटा चेन्स नहीं है. सो द गामा चेन्स दे कंपनसेट टू एब्जॉर्ब दीज अल्फा चेन्स एंड दीज प्रोड्यूस एच बी एफ. ओके, सो दीज प्रोड्यूसेस एच बी एफ एंड द रिमेनिंग अल्फा टू इट विल बाइंड टू द डेल्टा टू एंड इट विल फॉर्म एच बी ए टू HbA2. So there will be increase in the HbF and mildly increase in hemoglobin A2. The remaining free chains, now if there will be remaining free alpha chains, they form alpha 4. Okay, so just because there is deficiency of beta chain, there will be formation of HbF, formation of HbA2 and alpha 4 tetramers, which cause structural and functional changes in the red cell membrane. Red cell membrane becomes rigid and unstable. These are rapidly destroyed in bone marrow, spleen and liver. Okay, and this is called ineffective erythropoiesis, and the 60-70% of red cells are destroyed. Now, what is ineffective erythropoiesis? Increased red cell destruction in bone marrow causes expansion of bone marrow cavity, thinning of the cortex leading to skeletal deformities in thalassemia, increased destruction of red cells in extramedullary sites. Okay, we have seen in the medullary site, that means bone marrow cavity, will lead to expansion of bone marrow cavity, and when it is there in the extramedullary sites, it causes splenomegaly, hypersplenism, hepatomegaly, and this hypersplenism predisposes to infections. Increased destruction of red cells leads to increased free iron. Okay, so because of increased ineffective erythropoiesis, first there will be expansion of bone marrow cavity, second there will be splenomegaly, hypersplenism and hepatomegaly, and there will be increased free iron. And this increased free iron, it gets deposited in the organs like heart, liver, endocrine glands, resulting in heart failure, cirrhosis, growth retardation, gonadal failure, hypothyroidism and hypoparathyroidism, and diabetes also. Now, what are the laboratory findings in thalassemia major? So first we will look histogram. What is histogram? Basically histogram tell, this is histogram is a graph that tells us all the parameters like hemoglobin, related with the hemoglobin, RBCs, WBCs, platelets. Okay, so the hemoglobin, we can see here there is anemia, and usually in the major anemia is of severe degree, that is 3-9 gram per deciliter of hemoglobin we will see. Now MCV is reduced, as we have seen MCV is reduced, MCH is reduced, MCHC is mildly reduced. Total count increased when there will be infections, that will lead to increase in the total count, that is leukocytosis, and platelet count is normal to reduced in cases of hypersplenism. Now what is peripheral blood smear examination? Here we see in RBCs we see marked anisopoikilocytosis. What is anisopoikilocytosis? Anisocytosis means there is different sizes of RBCs, and poikilocytosis means there is different shapes of RBCs. So we see marked anisopoikilocytosis, and there is microcytosis. Okay, this is a type of microcytic hypochromic anemia. Okay, so there is microcytosis, there maybe some macrocytes and spherocytes. There is marked hypochromia. Then target cells, we have seen why there are target cells, and teardrop cells. Now again, there is evidence of increased and dyserythropoiesis. There are evidences of increased erythropoiesis, dyserythropoiesis in the peripheral smear, like polychromasia, okay, nucleated RBCs. We get nucleated, usually RBCs or mature RBCs or mature erythrocytes, they don't have nucleus. Nucleus, they get extruded before the mature RBCs form. But there are more and more nucleated red blood cells in peripheral blood and punctate basophilia. Now, WBC, we see leukocytosis, they shift to left because of infection. The platelets, normal or reduced in number. Some larger platelets may be seen. Reticulocyte count is raised up to 10% or more. Why there will be reticulocytosis? Because when there will be anemia, then the bone marrow, it releases more and more immature RBCs in the peripheral blood, and it will lead to reticulocytosis. Okay, and the reticulocyte count is increased. Now we get bone marrow aspiration. Here ME ratio is myeloid erythroid ratio. So there is increased erythropoiesis, then there will be decrease ME ratio. M is reduced, erythropoiesis is increased, so ME ratio is decreased. There is erythroid hyperplasia showing micronormoblastic maturation. Okay, as you have seen, there is microcytosis in peripheral smear, so the bone marrow erythropoiesis is micronormoblastic. Now serum bilirubin, increase total and indirect bilirubin. First, there will be increase in the indirect bilirubin because of hemolysis. When there will be hemolysis, hemoglobin gets destructed and there will be release of bilirubin. So indirect bilirubin is increased, and after that, because of this increased bilirubin, there is pigmented gallstones, and it will obstruct the biliary tract and leading to increased conjugated bilirubin also, and increased urobilinogen. Serum haptoglobin is reduced. Why haptoglobin is reduced? Because haptoglobin is there for binding with the free bilirubin. So when there will be more free bilirubin, indirect bilirubin, so there is decrease in the haptoglobin. Serum LDH is increased, uric acid is increased, however gouty arthritis is rarely reported. Iron and ferritin elevated. As we have seen, in cases of thalassemia major, there is destruction of RBCs or the ineffective erythropoiesis, there is more and more iron load, overload. So this iron overload, because of this iron overload, there is increase in the serum iron and ferritin. Ferritin is nothing but the storage iron, so there will be increase in the ferritin. Now the serum transferrin is completely saturated. Okay, now what is osmotic fragility test? Here the osmotic fragility test, we evaluate the relationship of RBC surface area to its volume. Here we have seen volume is reduced and RBC surface area is increased. So target cells have increased surface area to volume, so there is increased resistance to hemolysis, and therefore the cells have decreased osmotic fragility. So in cases of thalassemia major, the cells have decreased osmotic fragility. Now what are the diagnostic tests for this thalassemia, beta thalassemia major? First is hemoglobin electrophoresis. Hemoglobin electrophoresis is a semi-quantitative estimation. Okay, so in cases of beta plus thalassemia, beta plus means beta major thalassemia. Beta major thalassemia, we get HbA and HbA2, and a variable but significantly elevated amount of HbF. So here this is the strip we get in Hb electrophoresis. So we will see the result here. This is cathode and this is anode, and this is the point of application. So we will see this is HbA, HbF, HbS, that is sickle, and HbA2. So in cases of beta plus thalassemia major, you will get HbA, HbA2 and HbF. Okay, that is in cases of beta plus, and beta plus is minor thalassemia minor or thalassemia media, means heterozygous state. And when there will be complete lack of beta chains, that is beta zero, bilkul bhi nahi hai beta chains, then it is major. So major mein kya hoga, beta nahi hai, tab kya hoga, more and more alpha chains they get absorbed by HBF, that means absorbed by gamma chains, and it will produce HBF. So here this is broad band, HBF is broad, means more and more. Why HBF is produced? Because gamma chains has higher affinity for alpha chain, and there is also HBA too, but there will not be any HBA. Why there is not there will not be any HBA? Because there is no beta chains, and if there are no beta chains, so there will not be any alpha 2 beta 2, so there will not be any adult hemoglobin. So you have to draw this diagram in your exams. Now what is HPLC? Second diagnostic test is HPLC, high performance liquid chromatography, and it is quantitative estimation, and it is preferred over hemoglobin electrophoresis. Here you will get the amount of different types of hemoglobin. So this is quantitative. So in cases of beta zero or major thalassemia, there will not be any A, so zero, A to 1.5 to 4%, and F is 98%. And in beta thalassemia, beta plus, that is heterozygous form, 10 to 90% is A, 1.5 to 4% is A2, and 10 to 90% is F. So there is some amount of A because there is some amount of beta chain in heterozygous form. Now coming to the beta thalassemia minor, it is also known as straight. So it is a heterozygous state for beta thalassemia gene. Mutated beta gene is inherited from one parent and the other gene is normal. So it is very mild disorder with little or no anemia. Condition is commonly detected on routine hematological screening. So what you will get in laboratory findings, histogram, hemoglobin is mildly reduced, there is mild anemia, okay, in the range of 12.7 to 10.9. RBC count is elevated, MCV markedly reduced, MCH reduced, MCHC normal or slightly decreased, and REW is normal. REW represents anisocytosis, so there will not be any anisopoikilocytosis, so REW is normal. In peripheral smear examination, RBCs, we see mild anisopoikilocytosis, microcytic hypochromia is there, target cells are there, and basophilic stippling may be seen. WC platelets, they have no abnormality. This is very important test here, it is Nesterov test. But before this, we will revise some clinical features of this beta thalassemia, because it is very important clinical to understand about the clinical features. So first, age. What is the age of presentation of beta thalassemia major? It is second half of first year. Now the second clinical feature is pallor. Why pallor? Because of anemia. Third is splenomegaly and hypersplenism. The fourth one, thalassemic facies. We have seen 5 thalassemic facies. We will see in this thalassemia, because this thalassemic facies consist of frontal bossing and prominent cheek bones. What is frontal bossing? When the skeletal this skull bone, it gets expanded because of extramedullary erythropoiesis, then there will be frontal bossing, and this is also the region of prominent cheekbones, and this is also known as mongoloid facies. Now the fifth one is jaundice. We have seen jaundice because of hemolysis, bone changes. If we see the x-ray of skull of x-ray of skull, then we will see hair on end appearance. Okay, hair on end. There are perpendicular trabeculations. Perpendicular trabeculations. Okay. Now, there will be increased chances of infection. hepatomegaly, and there are features of iron overload, iron deposition, like heart failure, cirrhosis, growth retardation, hypothyroidism, hypoparathyroidism, and diabetes. Now, what is the course of this thalassemia major? What happened? So, if there will be regular transfusion to the baby, so they can reach up to the puberty if there will be regular blood transfusions. And also, if we give chelating agents for what? To chelate iron, okay, to reduce iron from the body. We chelate iron from chelating agents. So when they use chelating agents, then the patients do well and can reach up to the adulthood. So there are two important points in management of these patients. They should have regular blood transfusions and they should take chelating agents, and there are other things like bone marrow transplantations also. Now, what is Nesterov test? Nesterov test is naked eye single tube red cell osmotic fragility test, and it is useful screening test for beta thalassemia minor. It is a screening test and it is for minor. Okay, so here this is the principle. Here normally red cells put in saline solution, they begin to lyse at saline concentration 0.4 to 0.5%, but when in cases of beta thalassemia minor, there is resistance in the osmotic lysis. Why? Because of same reason, because of decreased volume surface ratio or increased surface volume ratio. So there will be resistant in osmotic lysis. So lysis now begin at saline concentration 0.4 to 0.35%, okay, and it is not completed even at 0.1% solution. So here this is the positive Nesterov test in the left side, and the right side you can see negative Nesterov test. Okay, so what is the interpretation here? In the positive Nesterov test, we cannot see lines of the paper which we put behind the tube. So there is haziness of solution. Why there is haziness of solution? Because there is no hemolysis. If there is hemolysis, then there will be clearing of the solution and we can obviously see the lines. Okay, so if it is hazy, we cannot see, then it is positive Nesterov test and it is screening test for beta thalassemia minor. Now it should be differentiated from iron deficiency anemia because there is microcytosis and hypochromia in both the cases. So beta thalassemia minor, there is microcytosis, hypochromia and reduction in MCV. They are relatively marked considering the mild to absent anemia. Red cell and isocytosis is marked in iron deficiency anemia, which is indicated by increased RDW. Okay, while in minor it is normal, so there is normal RDW. There are some other tests for this beta thalassemia minor: serum iron, ferritin, transferrin. They are normal, which are deranged in major. Reticulocyte count twice the normal. Okay, not much increase. Osmotic fragility is decreased. Hemoglobin electrophoresis depends on the subjective error. And HbA1c is the diagnostic test when we get HbA2 3.5 to 7%. More than 3.5% of hemoglobin A2 we see in cases of minor. There are some objective type of questions which you should know and you will solve them and read from the books. There are some questions 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and the keys are there below. So this finishes all about the thalassemia. In the next lecture, we will see sickle cell disorders and other types of hemolytic anemia. Thank you so much for listening.